Now on with the Pecha Kucha Ability Show. They wrote it in giant capital letters, like, Quinn, be really excited. Up first is Kate Farr, representing the Institute for Stuttering Treatment and Research. Kate hopes to debunk myths about stuttering and promote compassion about this neurophysiological disorder. Kate works with clients with a variety of speech and language disorders and understands the day-to-day challenges faced by those who stutter. She strives to promote confidence, control, and effective communication while working as a team with her clients and family. So please welcome Kate to the stage.
Like they said, I'm Kate Farr, and I'm a speech-language pathologist at the Institute for Stuttering Treatment and Research. And I'm just going to let them get a moment to get my photos up there. Okay, so the Institute for Stuttering Treatment and Research, we call it ISTAR for short, so that's how I'll be referring to it. But one of the amazing things I feel about ISTAR is that it brings people from all over the world together in one place, and people who stutter who may never have met anyone else who stutters. And maybe you're like some of our clients today and you don't know anyone else who stutters, but I'm pretty sure you've heard of some of these famous people that I'm going to be discussing today, like Mr. Bean. So Mr. Bean continues to stutter, and he says that his stuttering comes and goes. He says that it's also less severe when he's playing a character in a TV show or a movie than it is in his day-to-day life. And this is actually pretty common. So when we're acting or singing, doing a funny voice or putting on a fake accent, then we're actually using different areas in our brain than when we're having a conversation. So it's not uncommon for stuttering to be a bit less severe in those times. He also says that his stuttering varies day to day, and this makes sense as well. For most people, their stuttering goes in ups and downs. Another famous person that you've probably heard of is Marilyn Monroe, and she's stuttered throughout her life, and she talks about her stuttering being really tied to the stress that was going on in her day-to-day life. So if her stress was high, her stuttering was severe, and it could really impact her ability to say her lines. She actually developed her trademark breathy voice as a management strategy for her stuttering. James Earl Jones, or maybe you know him as the man behind Darth Vader's powerful voice, he stuttered as a child, began stuttering as a child, and he thought it was because he was imitating his cousin who also stuttered. Research tells us that it wouldn't be due to imitating his cousin, but more likely there's a genetic component to his stuttering because he has a family history of stuttering. He was quite affected by his stuttering as a child, and he'd only talk to his family and the animals on their family farm. He was selectively mute with most other people. And unfortunately, that's not unique to him. He also talks about being teased in Sunday school, and we know that teasing and bullying can be a huge concern for children and adults who stutter. And it's often, management strategies are often incorporated into our treatment at ISTAR. In interviews, he talks about knowing that his stuttering is never going to leave him, and he's right, because there is no cure for stuttering. But there are very effective treatment techniques for children and adults who stutter. He also tells people that he word switches or avoids words that start with the letter M when he thinks he's going to stutter. And unfortunately, this means he's not always saying what he wants to say or articulating himself in exactly the way that he'd like to. Being able to communicate and express ourselves and use language is hugely important every day in our lives. And I really think that Noam Chomsky summed it up very well when he said, "A language is not just words. It's a culture, a tradition, a whole history that creates what a community is. It's all embodied in a language." People who stutter have a fragile speech motor system in their brain. And this means that when they're talking, their muscles don't coordinate in the same way that they do for someone who doesn't stutter. And this creates certain repetitions or bumps or sticks in their speech. And this is the part of stuttering that you can see and hear. Severity can vary day to day or depending on the speaking situation, like doing a presentation, or with stress levels and fatigue. So if we think about stuttering as an iceberg, Then the small part above the surface there, that's that part that you can see and hear, the repetitions and the bumps. And under the water, that larger portion, that's the part that encompasses someone's negative feelings about themselves, their speech, word switching, avoidances, shame, or guilt. This is the part of stuttering that really hurts. Throughout my time at iStar, I've had the opportunity to speak with a lot of people who stutter about things they feel they might have done in their lives had they not stuttered. Things like answering questions in class, finishing high school, going to university, and having a family. Our clients also come to us with goals, and some of their goals might be things that you or I would take for granted, like reading a story to their child, ordering a double-double at Tim Hortons, and saying their name. The challenges that people who stutter face in their life are real, and it's really heartbreaking when you speak to a 10-year-old who says she tells the teacher she doesn't know the answer because she's afraid she's going to stutter. Or you talk to an adult who takes all the overtime shifts at work because her boss tells her she has to, and that she wouldn't be able to get a job anywhere else because she stutters. But I hope I haven't made stuttering sound too bleak, because some of the most amazing people I've met are people who stutter. And I feel my clients have taught me so much about courage, commitment, compassion, and acceptance. It's so incredible when we have teens and adults come to our 3-week treatment programs. They spend all day with us for 3 weeks. And throughout that time, they practice their fluency skills, and they break their cycles of avoidance and build up their confidence in communication. I know that I've never been to a 3-week course where I had to face my fears every single day. And I don't think I could do it with the same composure and drive that they do. Toward the end of our treatment programs, our clients often come to realize that although their stutter may have been a source of a huge amount of negativity or struggle in their life, there are positives to it as well with what it's taught them. So today I'm going to leave you with their words, because we asked them to tell us what they love about their stutter. I love my stutter because it has made me a good listener. I love my stutter because it helps me know my friends like me for me. I love my stutter because it has taught me persistence. I love my stutter because it helps me persevere. I love my stutter because it has made me motivated. I love my stutter because it has made me who I am. Thank you.
They took away my podium.
Feels weird. Thank you, Kate, so much for sharing your story and the story of some of the clients that you work with. Next up is the Ponich sisters, Michelle and Tanya. This dynamic duo are both incredibly accomplished in their own right, and share their message of leading an inspired life through North America. Soul Sisters is a story of unconditional love that inspires, empowers, and reminds us why we shouldn't take life so seriously. Please welcome Michelle and Tanya. They're just getting mic'd up. I tell a joke, but I don't know any. Tell us about your puppy. Maybe I could share why I'm here today. Is that all right with you, Leslie? For those of you who don't know, maybe you do, maybe you follow me on social media, my father is a quadriplegic. He has been for the last just about 7 years. The anniversary is actually coming up in 5 days. So as soon as Leslie asked me to come and be involved in this, I said absolutely, no questions asked. Our family has changed completely and utterly since it happened. And we want to make sure that our family as a whole wants to make sure that everyone can feel included in everything, because how can you feel included if you can't even get in the door in some situations? So that's kind of why I'm here today. And I think Michelle and Tanya are ready. Perfect.
Thank you.
You ready? There may be no relationship that affects us more profoundly, that's closer, finer, harder, sweeter, happier, sadder, and more fraught with woe than the relationships we have with our brothers and sisters. There's a power in the sibling bond. Most importantly, the sibling bond can be a thing of abiding love. In 1979, The Muppet Show was released. My Sharona by the Knack topped the Billboard charts. Muhammad Ali retired from boxing. Farrah Fawcett was on many, many bedroom walls. And on February 25th, my sister Tanya was born. It was not expected that she would be born with Down syndrome, but it was celebrated.
Is this on?
Yep.
Can you hear me?
There.
No?
Keep, just start reading, okay?
As my sister said, it was a surprise that I was born with Down syndrome. Really, I am the lucky one. I was born with designer jeans, and my sister has to buy them.
Oh, thank you.
When I look back at pictures of myself, see a little girl that I was determined learner. I was driven, but I had people in my corner who loved and believed in me.
When I look back, I do not remember when I was first spoken to about Tanya being born with Down syndrome. It never made a difference to me. She's my sister. For Tanya and I, the expectations were always the same. We had responsibilities and learned early on that there was no room for it's all about me.
Part of the reason for my success in life is that my family accepted me for me and not any label I might have. Our nanny was one of the most important people in my life. She was patient and calm. She knew that I would learn and respond best to people who had these qualities.
The influences that Tanya and I have had in our life have been very diverse. Because of the people we were surrounded by growing up, we learned very early on that there was a beauty in not being a cookie cutter mold of someone, and that you don't have to come from a certain station in life to be a good human being. We were very lucky to have parents who taught us these lessons by show and tell.
Fast forward a number of years. At times, it's not easy being born with special needs. I have frustrations, but I have a sister who reminds me that I play an important role in our world today.
We have been so fortunate to have many amazing experiences together. We've traveled throughout North America speaking to diverse audiences about Down syndrome and our experiences as siblings. We both believe that if society would just stop, look and listen, and open their eyes to all of the wonderful possibilities that lie within each and every person born with Down syndrome, it would be amazing. We are more alike than different.
My friends and I had the big task of living in two worlds. One where we are looked upon as human beings first. Then there is this other world, one that still thinks we are not capable of anything more than being happy, giving good hugs, a greater world that we want to contribute to, and what want to not just be part of.
We come into this world and we're given a set of tools, and we hopefully keep adding to that toolbox. Unfortunately, we live in a complex, harsh world that still lacks compassion and acceptance. We who possess these tools have a tremendous opportunity and responsibility to step forward and do our part. Do a little, do a lot. Just do something. There's a tremendous power in one.
I know that at one time in our world that people like me were hidden, put away in a hospital. Part of my job as an advocate is to defy outdated stereotypes. I really like this part. If only the people from decades gone by could see me now. Eat your heart out. Okay. Our mom has always had the saying, stand up and be somebody. I know for me, it means to be proud of who I am, to stand up for myself and for my friends, and to have a voice in this world.
My belief in this population knows no bounds. Tanya and her friends with Down syndrome have been some of my greatest teachers. I see a world through their eyes that is much simpler, filled with more compassion. All of their actions and words come from a genuine place, and there are more celebrations and definitely more dancing. Tanya constantly reminds me, just by who she is, to slow down. Life doesn't need to move so fast. The ability my sister has to see the world as it should be, living in the moment, appreciating the simplest things, this is what life is about. She reminds me that we are never too old to be silly and that laughter is always the best medicine.
When we were little, I was told that I was a good one. Guess what? And my sister was a naughty one. I still believe that is true. My sister can be pretty intense at times, but she can also be a big goof and get on my nerves. Sisters, be grateful in your lives. Use your words wisely. They are powerful tools. And my biggest piece of advice, remember to be a kid at heart. Peter Pan never grew up, so why shouldn't we? Thank you.
Tanya being born with Down syndrome does not define who she is. It's just a small part of the dynamic woman you see before you today. Tanya and people with disabilities challenge us to be better. They challenge us to be the change we want to see in our communities, in our world. Let's join them in the quest. Let us lead the charge. Let's each lead an extraordinary life. Dare to be remarkable. We promise that your life will become something you never imagined.
And also, I would like to have a special thanks to Pecha Kucha, because I never met them before. This is my first time meeting them. And also, I'd like to thank my best friend, Joey and Steven. Thank you for coming. I love you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. You have to give Quinn her mic back, okay?
Can I get another round of applause for Michelle and Tanya? That was just awesome. We also want to give a shout out to Tanya and Joey. They have been asked to speak about living their dreams through the Foundation Huron. So the Foundation Huron is an innovative service organization that provides the opportunity for young adults to make a successful transition from high school to life in the community. On March 10th, Tanya and Joey will be featured at Foundation Huron's event, Big Dreams. So congratulations to both of you guys. Next is Linda Marie Johnson with her presentation, Easy Access to a Life of Luxury. Now, we've made some pretty great strides when it comes to adopting inclusive designs into public spaces, especially in the last couple of decades. What about introducing the same improvements into our private spaces? As a self-proclaimed carpenter and home renovator, I don't know what that means, self-proclaimed. Linda Marie takes these redesign and construction projects and involves all family members to enjoy quality time together. So please welcome Linda Marie.
Unlike most innovations inspired through biomimicry, the wheel is an idea entirely of man's making. Pioneered in Mesopotamia as a potter's wheel 3,500 years ago, it was adopted for transportation 300 years later. Today, because of the immeasurable ease and pleasure the wheel adds to our lives, we are constantly adapting our built environment to accommodate it. Bike and traffic lanes, strollers on sidewalks, and curb cuts for those great big large Canadian monster hockey bags. However dear the wheel has become in our daily lives, one wheel that many of us fear is the wheel on a wheelchair. Yet this is a reality for a growing number of Canadians. In 2012, up to 2 million lived with a mobility challenge. Today, the voice of those living with mobility challenges, however, has been strengthened by a number of factors: our aging population, an increasing number of young Canadian veterans, and the expectations of today's youth who have grown up in a culture of equality. Inclusive change in our built environment is painless when we set our mind to it. The garage door opener is one change in access that every one of us likely wouldn't live without. In push, I might be able to manually open at least the small door, but in an Edmonton winter, that ain't gonna happen. Changes in universal access had luxury to the lives of each and every one of us. An inviting beachfront entry pool exemplifies one such luxury. I, for one, appreciate no longer having to take that frigid plunge in. Why then have we failed to apply this same level of luxury to the lifestyles we enjoy regarding our home's access? Some say that about 80% of a community can be made up of housing. Yet we continue to have a bittersweet romance with stairs that more often than not turns out to be bitter rather than sweet. One woman, Eleanor Smith, had the insight to say enough's enough. In 1986, she introduced Visitability, requiring new homes to be built with no step entrances, wider doors and hallways, and a main floor bathroom. While a no step front entry leading from a walkway or driveway is preferred, back or side door works. It's crucial we include them during construction because of the cost. Ramps are an option, but are not encouraged as they are seen as unattractive and discriminatory. Besides, today's designers possess the potential to produce more creative designs. Freedom of movement on the main floor is one challenge we've reduced by removing the restrictive nature of walls, creating a desire for open concept space. Eleanor's final request is an accessible bathroom on the main floor, big enough for someone using a mobility device. She wants everyone to be able to take for granted that there will be a place to go when they have to go. Visitability grants us flexibility, not always requiring us to plan ahead. This no-step entry is a godsend for this couple. Who would want to be held responsible for impeding the entry of this bride and groom? She looks strong enough to take on anyone that may challenge her ability to access what comes next once they're inside. Not sure about you, but I wouldn't want to have to worry that a few love handles might prevent me from navigating my home. This may look fun today, but when I was expecting my twins, futile would have been a better word. Okay, I think anyone would find it hard to argue that this family wouldn't easily benefit from a larger bathroom on the main floor. Learning by association concerning familiarity of task location could become a problem in the future. Contrary to what many believe, these changes can be done in an unassuming way, adding increased function and beauty to most housing styles. Extremely marketable because of limited supply, these homes are expected to increase in value as our population ages. Incorporated into modern homes, including the skinny infill, visitability endorses sustainability. It also reduces the need to renovate for all stages of life. Remarkably, during its lifetime, a home built today has a 60% chance of housing someone with a disability over its lifespan. Visitability allows everyone to enjoy the company of others in the warmth of our homes. It also avoids some of us always to play host. Because of the access barriers, we unconsciously impinge on ourselves and others. Once again, Elner's asks are simple and reasonable, requiring modifications to our new homes that we can all benefit from. No step entrances, wider doors and hallways, and a main floor bathroom. Let's be honest, visitability pampers our secret desire for an increasingly self-indulgent lifestyle. Visitability's ease of access opens the door to greater opportunities for enjoyment, creating homes that each and every one of us has easy access to and within. Houses that in unique ways stunningly evolve into comfy, cozy homes, bearing a universally warm invitation of welcome. Visitability understands what community is all about, and that when we strive to envision, design, and inspire change, we all stand to benefit, not only adding luxury, but the rush of friendship to boot. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much, Linda Marie. Now, last to present before our quick all-ability Zumba break, yeah, all of you will be taking part, is Caitlin Wheeler. As a part of the Steward Center, Caitlin is responsible for fitness programs. She works one-on-one with participants to make sure they achieve their fitness goals. Caitlin is here to share some stories about the Steward Center and how it has come to serve over 1,100 participants who experience disability. Caitlin, everyone.
Pierre Trudeau was the Prime Minister, and the Bee Gees went to number one. At the U of A, Dr. Bob Stedward saw there weren't any training facilities for athletes experiencing disability, so he created one himself. It was called the Research and Training Center for Athletes with Disabilities. Now, athletes with physical impairments had a space to train just like any other athlete. After the Man in Motion tour by Rick Hansen in 1987, the center was renamed the Rick Hansen Center as a tribute to Rick's achievement. The center was expanding. Not only were there athletes, but also adults who wanted to keep fit. The center opened its access to all adults with neuromuscular impairment. There are still participants working out here today that started in the 80s, like Casey, who works out with us 2 times a week. Here he is then and now. Researchers were busy at the U of A exploring functional electrical stimulation for exercise. This was first developed using a rowing machine to stimulate weakened muscles to contract. Also, in the year 2000, the center was renamed the Stedward Center for Personal and Physical Achievement to tribute its founder. In 2005, Karen Slater started the CAGE program for children and youth ages 4 to 19. This program offered group programs and one-on-one motor support and fitness sessions. The CAGE was able to accommodate approximately 90 kids per semester. This program is now known as Free to Be Me. In 2008, the transition program began. Do any of you want to exercise at Kinsmen or Terwilliger or the YMCA? We can help you with that. This program works with over 30 community fitness centers in Edmonton and surrounding areas. 2013 marked the start of youth transition. Not only do we help youth in the community, but also in schools. Working alongside a workout buddy, we help to build confidence and independence for youth within a fitness setting. Don't those bicep curls look awesome? We recently assessed community fitness centers using the AIM Free survey. Each site was provided with recommendations on how to improve accessibility. Simple improvements can be made in professional behavior, professional support, policies and programs, and exercise equipment and environment. That brings us to present day. Now there are 5 programs within the Steadward Center: functional electrical stimulation, adult fitness, free to be me, athlete development for para sport, and transition. Our focus is on teaching, research, and service delivery. Here's Tracy doing his FES. We are working with other professionals in Alberta who also use FES with clients to share resources, protocols, and knowledge. We believe people experiencing muscle paralysis should have access to this equipment in the hospital, in a specialized site, and even then their community. There are over 130 participants working out in the adult fitness program. Here is Jordan and Peter in the PELS program working on cardio with the arm ergometer. This is a great program where students get hands-on experience working in a fitness setting with individuals experiencing disability, and participants get a personal trainer. Here is the Athlete Development for Parasport program. Whether athletes want to compete at the recreational, national, or even international level, we can help take training and competition to the next level. We have trained athletes that recently competed in the Para Pan Am Games. In partnership with the U of A, the Steadward Center is working to integrate para sport into the green and gold system and use sport science to develop, mentor, and train para athletes and their coaches. If there are any athletes in the crowd, come and see me after. Free to Be Me aims to empower kids to be physically fit and active, experience success, and become vital, self-determined adults. This year, we will be celebrating Free to Be Me's 10-year anniversary. We now can work with approximately 600 kids per year. This is Manny working on throwing. These student volunteers are working with him to build his motor skills. Of course, we could not run programs without our volunteers. We have over 200 center-wide. These volunteer programs shape future health professionals that think inclusively. Last year, the center created Move and Play cards in partnership with Free to Be Me and Be Fit for Life. This is a resource package aimed to promote understanding and create more inclusive environments for physical activity. We have sold over 400 across the country. Here are my wonderful colleagues at the Steadward Center. In 2015, we collaborated to provide the second adapted physical activity symposium to educate and inform professionals. This helped professionals understand everyone's unique abilities and help people just like you achieve their fitness goals. The center just released its new strategic plan that will guide us into the next 5 years. I can't wait for what's in store. Our new mission is to inspire individual achievement by conducting and applying innovative research, widely sharing expert knowledge, and delivering highly successful programs. I am very excited to announce the opening of our new center. In spring 2016, we will unveil our brand new facility, over 17,000 square feet of space. Our vision is for individuals to be active for life. More people will be able to access this center from ages 4 to 94. I wonder if Dr. Steadward had any idea how many people his center would impact back in the 70s. He had a vision, and we are still working towards that vision today in a much bigger capacity all over Alberta. Maybe tomorrow we will have impact across Canada and then the world. I am so excited for what the future holds. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Caitlin, and that was a great introduction for what's up next, our break activity. I'd like to invite Quinn Tang up for All Ability Zumba.
Thank you. Oh. Okay, how's my hair? Excellent. How many of you have heard Zumba before? Sweet. How many of you have done Zumba before? Oh, there you go. We have somebody in the crowd super excited already. Well, we've already seen what North American Zumba is about. What I'm about to introduce to you is Chinese Zumba. It's also called Guangchang Wu. What it is actually designed specially for seniors. Every night, when you go on into the schoolyard or parks, you'll see hundreds, sometimes thousands of grandmas, grandpas, great-grandpas dancing in the park. The reason why I adapted is because the movements and the music can be easily adapted for anybody with any kind of ability. I've just had my seventh surgery last Wednesday, and I started doing Zumba about 4 days ago. So it doesn't matter what stage and how much pain you're in, you can always modify it to fit your needs. Okay, so before we start, give yourself, you can either sit or stand for this. Give yourself a room about arm length with the person beside you if you can. I'm gonna make you move, yes. Come on, ladies and gentlemen. If you can move a little bit, give yourself some room. You have 3 seconds. 3, 2, 1. There you go. We are going to do Zumba to a song that talks about all the great landscapes in China. And the movements I'm going to introduce you are derived from Mongolia. So we're going to mix cultures a little bit. And while we're dancing, I want you to think of two things. On the grassland, any grassland you'll see and experience, there are two things, grass and birds. And that's what you will be in this particular Zumba dance. Not Zumba, but Zumba. Okay, first little movement, rotate your shoulder. We're just gonna do a warm up before we actually get into the Zumba. So shoulder rotation is one of the movements we'll do. And move your arms back and forth, like how the grass would be doing, or the grass would move when the wind is blowing on it. And we're going to do a few little movements. We're gonna turn to the side. We're gonna tap our hands forward, sideways. Then we're gonna spread our wings, or the birds, as far as you can reach, and hug yourself. Ready? Do that again. We're gonna tap forward, tap sideways, spread your wings, and hug yourself. There you go. And that's the two movements we'll be doing lots of. Are you ready to Zumba? Okay, shake it off. And one last one. We're gonna be doing some turns. For those of you who are sitting and not able to turn, I want you to turn with your hands, like this. Ready? Turn with your hands. If you can turn with your hand, turn with your heads. We're gonna stretch all parts of your body that you can move. Okay, hit it, boys. Rotate your shoulders. Lean your body back. Okay, we're going to reach across the field.
最高的山峰
Okay, we're getting blown backwards by the wind. Oh, we're blowing forward. just blowing right in the same spot. Ready to fly. Hug yourself. Let's shake it off. Ready, reach across the field again. Blowing backwards. Forward. Brand the spot. It's fly. 月亮之上嫦娥 在遥望着中国 Shake it off. Ready to turn to the side. Front. Side. Side. Turn to the outside. 中国之最数也数 One more time to the outside. 最美色彩 Fly. One last time. You can spread your wings twice. 梦想是千年的飞天 Now turn around. I gotta fix my mic. Hey, we're getting blown sideways. Now we're getting blown. Reach your arms as high as you can. Take it off. Ready to reach. Reach. 最大的盆地, 是他的母盆地, Getting blown backwards. 他的母和上, Forward. 倒映着胡杨的前移, right in the spot. 最大的草原, 是内蒙古草原, Ready to hug. Spread. 飘出, hug. Shake it off. Off the time. Reach. 最大的岛屿是宝岛台湾 Backwards. 日月潭上望 Forward. 那不像月儿明 Red spot. 最大的广场是天安门广场 Ready to fly.
它就矗立在我 那最爱的北京城
Take it off. Side again. Fly. Hug. Turn sideways.
中国之最数也数不清
One more time.
最美的地方是中国人的心灵 最美的心愿
Twice. And turn. We're going to do it four more times. Side. Twice more. One last one. Turn, last time. Feel your wings. Let the music be the wind. Now be the grass. Reach. Reach. Good job, everybody. Just to let you know, I think we probably just made history today because it has never been done with a group of people such as us outside of China or with anybody with a disability before. So good job, everybody. Thanks.
She seems so quiet and nice and calm today. But from what I know, she's actually one of the roughest rugby players there is. So there's two very different sides to you. I've just learned, Quang. That was very fun. Thank you so much. Let's continue with our presentations now. Next up is Dr. Anna Maria Lucas-Osma. Originally from Spain, Dr. Lucas-Osma is a veterinarian and has a PhD in neuroscience. That's amazing. She also recently medaled at the Canada Winter Games for Team Alberta in para-Nordic cross-country skiing. And she traveled to Canada from Spain to follow her dream of working in spinal cord research while overcoming obstacles. And she is always up for a challenge, so hopefully this is one of her new challenges today. Please welcome Dr. Lucas-Osma.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. As I say, as you see, I have a very long name. I have two family names. And as well, I have a very strong accent. So as you say, as you can guess, I am not really Canadian. Even when it's funny, because a lot of people ask me if I am from Quebec. But I am from Spain. So here is a picture of my family. And I want to show you that because in 2011, I decided to leave my country, my family, my friends, everything, and move to Edmonton. And was because after finishing my PhD in neuroscience, I decided to follow my dreams to work in research, in spinal cord research. So I started to work in the University of Alberta. And to be honest, at the beginning, okay, in Spain we don't have too much snow. So I never know what it is to live with the snow, with ton of snow, and how hard it is to move with a wheelchair. So my first winter in Edmonton was hard, really, really hard. I was stuck with my wheelchair everywhere. And really, I hate the snow. But suddenly, you know, one of my friend Liz told me about para-Nordic ski, and really, everything changed. I tried, and was really, really hard, because, you know, you need a lot of up body. But, you know, I keep training, the important thing about cross-country ski is, you know, the first time when you start and you go downhill is when you realize that in the city ski, your skis are fixed. So really, you cannot turn and you cannot stop. So always you have a treat in front of you that can stop you. And so I start, you know, to have fun and training more and more. And I start to compete. Here is a picture with my coach and his son in my first race. And the city skin I'm using is for my coach, so it's too big for me. So the way I fix that is the Canadian way, with that tape. So I have to say that I'm becoming more and more professional with that tape. I have a lot of colors, and I use depend on my mood, depend on the competition, depend on everything. But I have to say that the master of the duct tape is my husband. He is the specialist who had typed me. I met him here in Canada 2 years ago, and the first question I asked him was, so, do you practice cross-country ski? And he said, well, you know, when I was in the school, and I said, don't worry, you will. And really, he had been skiing with me a lot. But I have to say, I think no was his choice to do that. So the question can be, why? Why I love cross-country ski? Why I love that? So the reason is freedom. To be honest, when I am in my city ski I am in the middle of nowhere, it's like amazing. And I can go a lot of places that usually with my wheelchair, is no way I can go. But the problem is sometimes the snow is not so fun, you know, and you do really cross-country ski when the snow covers even your boots. And the problem as well is the temperature. It's really, really cold. So always I am like an onion with layers and layers and layers of clothes, like 10 layers even, that even I cannot move. It's amazing. But the good thing is the competition. I don't know if any of you have competed in a sport. For me, when I start to, you know, when the time go and I start to compete, it's like the world stop. Only I can feel my breath, and only it's like try to, you know, to go faster, to learn from your mistake, and get better and better. It's amazing. But the amazing thing is when you finish, you know? Because it's like, okay, I didn't crash within a tree, I am alive, it's good. And always they have this kind, you know, when you finish your race, this cookies, that's very good. And always my treat is a hot chocolate. I love hot chocolate with Baileys. And another great thing is, you know, the people, because, okay, we are competing, but, you know, we're having fun. And to be honest, even in all Canada, it's not so many cities kids, so we have a very small community, so we have a very good relationship and we have a lot of fun. Everyone who cannot really ski stand can do city ski, so there are a lot of different kind of disabilities. And I have to say that my favorite race is the Berkey. It's a long distance cross country ski race. My first Berkey was like 2 weeks before I started to practice cross country ski. We did 13K, and after that we have done a few of them. Usually we do 31K, and I have to say that it's a survival race. It's amazing. And as said in my presentation, last winter I have the great honors to represent Alberta in the Canada Winter Games. I won 2 bronze and was amazing experience. Really, it make you to go far and keep training more. But I have to say that the city ski is not only good for ski or for training. As well, I can use another use like here doing some ice fishing. I have to say that I did first time 2 years ago and really enjoyed the five, 10 minutes at the beginning. A little really I didn't enjoy too much the ice fishing. To be sitting there is not really fun. But the good thing is like the, you know, my fun with my city ski is not only in winter. In summer, I take off my skis, I put some wheels and keep going. So always we have my city ski in the truck. So anytime we go, we stop and we do some training, you know. So it's great because really it's very easy to go for path. That with the wheelchair is not easy. Here is in a conference, it's called NeuroHike. So it's neuroscience and hiking. So in the break, we go to Jasper National Park to do some hiking. This is in the glacier. So the same, using my city ski, I can go everywhere with everyone. So it's too much fun. And even last summer, the department, when I working in the U of A, they organized one race. So I decided to race with my city ski. And it was too much fun to see the face of the people when I was passing them and I was faster than them. Really was good. And one really great thing now is finally I'm going to have my own city ski that's going to be fit me. So I don't need to use any more that tape, I hope. Anyway, I have that tape there yet because I'm getting ready. So my dream is keep working, keep getting better, getting faster, and I hope being part of the national team in the future. Thank you.
Apparently there's stairs. I've been trying to take a big step. Oh. Thank you very much, Dr. Lucas-Osma. Up next is Stephanie Dickie on behalf of artist Scott Berry. So Scott is an artist at the Nina Haggerty Collective. His latest show, Confusement, is currently touring Alberta. So that's why he couldn't be here today. Scott is in Calgary right now.
Boo. Did I do that out loud?
On behalf of Scott's presentation, Stephanie will touch base on some of his artwork and why he is the artist of the year. Please welcome Stephanie.
Thank you. Hello. So I'm Stephanie. I'm the community engagement manager for the Nina Haggerty Center for the Arts. We are an artist collective for adults with developmental disabilities, and we focus on supporting the artists in their professional art careers. So all the work that you are going to see in the exhibit is made by the artists of the Nina Haggerty Center. Today I'm here to talk to you about our artist of the year, Scott Berry, and the exhibit he inspired called Confusement. So the slide that just went by, that was Scott. Scott's been making art at the Nina Haggerty Center for many years, and in 2015, Scott was selected for our new Artist of the Year program. The centerpiece of the program is a large traveling art exhibit featuring the work of one of the artists from our collective. Scott named his show Confusement. The show is based on Scott's idea that it should be about the feeling of being stared at, but no one can see who you are. I think this is a pretty familiar feeling for a lot of us. Scott likes to use his art to do the talking about who he is and is adamant that he should be able to do things his way. Of the Nina Haggerty, Scott says the best thing we do is help him spread his wings and improve himself. So Confusement was a different kind of collaborative project for the Nina. It was the first time one artist from the collective inspired everyone else. We have 170 artists, and we all looked at his work and then responded directly with their own artwork. It's been an interesting process. We've been surprised and discovered some new things. Over the last 2 years, we've had an extra busy studio. The 9 artists have collaborated on a major puppet project and on animation projects. While we were working together on these projects, we began to realize that narrative is a big challenge. We all had so many different ideas for stories, it was really hard to pick just one. The artistic staff knew that we wanted to have a big group show of some kind to celebrate Artist of the Year. But every time the artistic staff came up with an idea for what that looked like, it just didn't feel right. We realized that working top-down was the wrong approach and began talking to the artists of the collective about what they thought an installation could look like for the NINA. When we asked Scott what he thought about an installation, we got an incredibly interesting answer. He wondered what it would be like if you walked through a door and traveled backwards in time. He had plenty of his own ideas and a large body of finished artwork that we all drew ideas from. Once Scott took the lead, important things began to happen. With Scott in charge and with the final say on all ideas, we ended up working together, staff and artists, to come up with the idea of creating life-size packing tape sculptures and surrounding them with art in many different media, all featuring eyeballs. Because the majority of Scott's work is black and white, we made the whole show monotone as well. The effect of Scott's work on some of the other artists in the collective was the first big surprise for us. Artists who had been stuck making the same thing for ages and ages were suddenly experimenting. They were still able to work repetitively, if that's what they liked, but now they were, instead of drawing similar shapes over and over, they were suddenly filling their pages differently. They were using different mediums, innovating, and trying whole new kinds of art altogether. We also discovered the importance of collaborative play. We had so much fun building bodies and eyeballs together. Scott's Confusement Show also allowed everyone to get involved. Our staff, the artists, visitors, caregivers, we all got involved in the project and contributed. This was one of the first times we've worked on a project where we all got to work together instead of having a clear divide between staff and artists. This open playing field is what the Nina Haggerty community is all about. And as we all worked together, the sense of friendship in the studios was so happy and invigorating. Another very important thing that happened in the creation of Confusement was that this showed the staff that we need to continue creating new structures for people to create in. By giving Scott the reins, instead of going with a route we tried before, we created spaces for the artists to experiment in new ways and to form new bonds and collaborations. The day the show was finally ready for installation was so exciting. It took a huge group effort. There were so many of us working in the gallery. We papered the walls, we hung flat artwork, we added a second row of paper to make a hallway around the whole space, and hung up all of the plastic figures from the ceiling. The space was transformed into a maze of eyeballs and bodies, and really embodied Scott's original idea that Confusement should have the feeling of being stared at, but no one can see who you are. The Confusement Show had excellent attendance, and got the attention of the larger Edmonton art community. By listening to our artists and supporting them and working on their ideas instead of directing the show, we were more successful than we had ever been before. Since our first Confusement Show at the Nina Haggerty Stollery Gallery, Scott's show has been shown in many different places around Alberta. After it left our gallery, the first place it was shown was in the lobby of Stantec. We installed the whole show again using the same materials but adapting it to the new space. Seeing all the corporate executives in their suits and ties in among the eyeballs and plastic figures was really fun. Next, the work was shown in downtown Edmonton in our new gallery space in City Centre Mall. This time, the show was in a window display, so we had to get creative in how we hung a show originally planned as a maze. The best part about it downtown is seeing it after sunset. Illuminated at night, the work takes on a whole new look. Then the work went onward to Spruce Grove Library, where we ran a workshop for students on how to make their own plastic figures. Currently, the show is on its last stop of its Alberta tour. Confusement is one of the feature exhibits at Calgary's Spark Disability Arts Festival. This year, Scott was also asked to attend the festival as a keynote speaker and as an art mentor to help other artists with disability expand their own art practices. So he's been sitting in Calgary for the last few days, talking to artists about their work and showing them how to make it better. We're so proud of Scott and what Confusement has accomplished this year. If you like what you've seen and you want to explore making art at the Nina Haggerty Center for the Arts with us, come talk to me after or just stop by the center for a visit. Thank you.
Absolutely wonderful. Thank you so much, Stephanie, and congratulations to Scott Berry. Our final presentation this year comes from Cindy DeBruin and the We Belong app. Cindy is the Executive Director of the Gateway Association, an Edmonton Employment and Family Resource Center that specializes in disability. The We Belong app helps make the business case for hiring people with disabilities. So will you please give a very warm welcome to Cindy.
Good morning. Thank you. It was a mic check, but. Gateway is an employment and family resource center that was started in 1975. Our priority was always to support families so that their loved ones with a disability would have a better quality of life. Our support work is done through workshops, crisis support, and mentorship work. In 2012, we started our We Belong initiative, which I'm here to tell you a bit more about. In 2009, we started a new project at Gateway that gave us the opportunity to hire a large number of colleagues who lived with disability firsthand. Now employed, the people were suddenly thriving in all areas of their personal life. Mental health was better, confidence grew, and relationships were being formed outside of work. It highlighted for us that being employed was a driver to ensuring a good quality life. We began to support people find and maintain work. Part of our commitment was to bring about awareness of the benefits of inclusive hiring to the business community. Hiring people with disabilities shouldn't be charitable. It makes good business sense. This is a demographic whose business companies should want. It impacts corporate culture, which money can't buy, and there are financial gains to be had. Even in the tough economic times that Alberta is currently experiencing, there are still many unfilled jobs. As many as 85% of people with developmental disabilities are unemployed. And each year, the number of people requiring some form of government services due to disabilities is increasing. Most people want work. They want to have something meaningful to do with their day. Research is being done to capture the benefits to workplace culture when a person with a disability works there. In one study, an employer said that it had taken several months for the company to realize that they needed the employee more than he needed them. His abilities were valued by staff. His dedication to learn and grow beyond his barriers strengthened the entire team. A problem area for the business was actually his greatest strength. Another employer asked the same question. He stated, it showed him and their other colleagues the world from a different perspective. He would travel by multiple buses to get to work, spending nearly as much time getting to and from than his actual shift. But he did so with commitment and a smile on his face. Culture is critical. But what about bottom line? A 2008 Compass Research poll found that 78% of Canadians said they were more likely to buy a product or service from a business that has a policy of hiring people with disabilities. This movement, this community, has purchasing power, and we needed to find a way to mobilize it. We looked to existing practices to see if there was another model to learn from and discovered the Grey Euro marketing strategy. In the mid-2000s, the focus in Europe was to encourage the baby boomers that were retiring to spend their monies in the union. This demographic with disposable income was specifically targeted, and various industries wanted to attract them. In recent years, we've begun to see the Pride movement be a similarly targeted market that businesses want to attract in order to get an upper hand on the competitor. So we created the disability dollar. In Alberta, more than 500,000 people live with disability. The average household spends over $71,000 on consumer goods and services each year. This means that an estimated $41 billion is spent in this province every year by people with disabilities and their families. We aren't the stereotype that relies on handouts. We contribute to the Alberta economy. And in an effort to showcase this market to employers, in 2014, we began cash mobbing local inclusive businesses. We mobilize people to go to a predetermined time and place and commit to spending $15. This brings business and attention that they may not have otherwise had. We've held 5 mobs to date. Our first at Planet Organic earned the business more than $5,000. Our second mob at Target, which apparently wasn't enough, generated over $6,000. We also mobbed a local nonprofit equine center for nearly $1,000, an Italian bakery for close to $3,000, and a pet store for $3,500. Not bad results for just 2 hours. Calgary has now started to host cash mobs, and we are now partnering with other local organizations here in Edmonton to co-host mobs. In 2016, we plan to simultaneously mob a national inclusive employer at a number of their different locations throughout the province. And we have also had conversations with employment organizations in both Vancouver and Newfoundland as well, who are hoping to participate. But we knew we needed to do more, and we needed to use the technology to the best of its ability. We wanted to find an easy way for people to mobilize behind this concept and be able to support it every day as individuals, not just at infrequent cash mobs. And we knew that it was important that there'd be no ownership. There was to be nothing gained personally or for our organization. So we built an app. It's a free app that you can download on both Google Play and the App Store. In researching our launch, we were surprised to find that this looks to be the only app of its kind in North America, and we suspect maybe even the world. This app has garnered huge national and international attention for what it's trying to achieve. And as a result, we launched a 2.0 version on May 19th to accommodate the national demand. The next time you and a friend are out and you decide to stop and grab a bite to eat, you can bring your business to a restaurant that's an inclusive employer. The location search uses a map, and based on your location at that time, will pinpoint the closest inclusive employers for you. You were spending the money anyways, so why not reward forward-thinking businesses? And you can also search by business type. If you plan on building a fence this weekend, before you head out to purchase $7,000 worth of supplies, why not look to see which home renovation store is inclusive and spend your money there? You'd be surprised to see how different corporations look at disability policy when it comes to employment. One large coffee chain encourages applicants with disabilities. Another quotes liability as a barrier. You can choose to spend wisely. And you can also search on the app by name. You can look to see if some of your favorite stores or businesses are inclusive employers. Markets are extremely fickle and often change. There is high competition to get your business and, more importantly, keep it. Things are tough enough to afford. So make your money count in more than one way. Frankly, in the grand scheme of things, can we afford not to? It's important to note that there are four criteria that defines employment as inclusive for the purposes of the app. The contract has to be directly with the employee and not an agency. They must be paid at least minimum wage. The employee must be in a workspace alongside other employees, so no enclaves. And the employee must be involved in all corporate culture, such as Christmas parties or TGIF after work beers. And it's easy to nominate a business that you know hires people with disabilities so that they too can be added to the app. The nomination is right on the app itself. Once inputted, it's vetted through Gateway to ensure the business consents and that all four criteria for being labeled as inclusive are met. Agencies who have a list of inclusive employers can backdoor this process by working with us directly and providing us with a list. If you would like more information about our employment work, you can visit our website at webelong.ca. Please download the app and encourage others to do the same. And take the time to mention to a manager or owner that you supported their business because they hire inclusively. Because only then will people with disabilities and those who believe in this movement truly mobilize and own their power. Thank you. Thank you.
So I just downloaded the app and tried it. It's really cool. Super easy to use. So make sure you download that app on your cell phones today so that you don't forget, like I would. Thank you, Cindy, and to all of our presenters. Just an added note, all of the bios of all of the presenters are available in your program that you received today. If you have any questions for them, feel free to come up. I'm sure they would be very happy to help you out with any questions that you may have. Let's give another round of applause for the fantastic presentations we had today. So that includes our formal program and Pecha Kucha, there we go, ability to presentations for this year. We would also like to invite you, as we are pleased to announce that due to this year's great response, we may be producing a third Pecha Kucha ability next year on or around December 3rd, same time, same place, you know where to find us. The call for presenters, it will be titled, drumroll, I forgot a line. Drum roll. Awesome. Pecha Kucha Ability 3. It's a great name.
Call for presenters will be sent out in late spring and late summer, so if you want to share your story, keep an eye out for that. Please join me in also thanking everyone who made this event possible. That includes our generous major sponsors. They are listed on the back of your program. I'll give a quick readout here. Wait till I finish reading them. Cameron Development Corporation, TELUS, the Royal Bank of Canada, Collin Bruce Mortgage Team, and the City of Edmonton Accessibility Advisory Committee, who support us for taking the lead role on this every year. So a huge round of applause for our sponsors here today. You guys are so energetic. I love it. A big thank you also goes out to Lorne with Amramp Alberta for building the accessible ramp for the stage. Alberta Human Services and the Premier's Council on the Status of Persons with Disabilities. Christina Fedoruk here at the Ramada Inn and her team for allowing us to host this very special event. Thank you very much. And finally, a heartfelt thanks to all of the volunteers and organizing committee members for your dedication. Thank you so much. These committee members work so hard to ensure that there's recognition to the community of persons with disabilities in Edmonton. And we will leave you with a few words: nothing about us without us. Thank you so much for joining us here today. Please. And now my favorite part of the day. Lunch is soon to be served right at the back of the, and the court yard room is still open with the community information fair, so make sure you check that out. Drive safe out there today, and thank you so much for allowing me to be here with you.